सहनाभवतु सहनो भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति। ॐ यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैस्साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः देवाय तस्मै नमः। सो यस्टर्डे वी वर डिस्कसिंग द मोस्ट इम्पोर्टेंट वर्ड्स ऑफ दिस चैप्टर। कर्मणि अकर्मयः पश्येत् अकर्मणि च कर्मयः। सबुद्धिमान मनुष्येषु संयुक्तः कृत्स्न कर्मकृत्। द वन हू सीज इनएक्शन इन एक्शन एंड एक्शन इन इनएक्शन, द वन हू सीज akarma in karma and karma in akarma, such a person is the wisest. Such a person is an enlightened yogi. So yesterday we were seeing that in this world there are two entities. What are they? Consciousness and matter. The world is matter, body is matter, mind is matter, intellect is matter. There is only one thing which is not matter, and that is consciousness. That is nothing but my own true self. It is the I am in me, the Sakshi in me, the witness in me. So what is its nature? It is Sat, Chit, Anand. It is absolutely perfect. It is birthless. It is deathless. It is immortal. It is all-pervading. It is eternal. It is actionless. Right? This is the nature of the self. And this is me, my true nature. But what is the mistake I have done? Instead of identifying with this consciousness, I get identified with the body-mind complex. So what happens when my identification is with body? Properties of the body become as though my properties. So what are the properties of the body? Body is temporary. Body is finite. Body is imperfect, and all actions take place at the body-mind level. So when I identify with the body, actions of the body as though become my actions. Actually, I am actionless, but the moment I identify with the body, now see what all happens. consciousness is infinite, but the moment consciousness identifies with the finite body, that infinite consciousness experiences jivatva, finitude. The infinite consciousness feels as though I am this finite body. The moment this immortal consciousness identifies with the mortal body, the immortal consciousness feels as though I am this mortal body. So the moment this identification happens, jiva is born, jivatma is born, individual is born, right? Ahankara is born. Ahankara means ego. So when does ego takes birth? As long as there is only consciousness, as long as there is identification with only consciousness, there is no ego. When does the ego take birth? The moment this infinite consciousness identifies with the finite body mind. So then I say, I am so and so. Actually, who are you? You are pure I am. What is your true nature? You are consciousness, which is only I am. But the moment identification happens, this I am starts feeling, I am so and so. I am man. I am woman. I am this. I am that. Whatever you have the description about yourself, everything is the description of the jiva. So the moment jiva is born, actions of the body as though become its action. So jiva is born, thus karta is born, doer is born, thus karma is born, and thus karma phala is born, and thus this karma phala again brings this jiva back to this world. So this is how the most inauspicious cycle begins. So if you want to put an end to this cycle, what you have to do? Problem started with identification, therefore solution lies in disidentification. Now the question is, can I directly disidentify? Because first of all, I am not even clear which is consciousness, which is thought, which is body. Where is the question of identifying and disidentifying? So please keep this in mind. This is not the first step in spirituality. Intellectually, you may appreciate, but you will not be able to practice this. Why is it difficult to practice? It is difficult to practice because this is not the first step. Then what is the first step? Karma Yoga is the first step. What is Karma Yoga? Earlier it is said, Vitaraga Bhayakrodhaha Manmayaha Mam Upasritaha. That you have to do first. Living a life, performing all actions as a worship of the Lord, in order to please the Lord. This way, when you lead a pure life, a life of purity, a life of nobility, following all the values, when you live a dharmic life, when the mind becomes pure, then you come to know the difference between consciousness and matter. Then only this segregation is possible. Otherwise it is not possible. Now since we are dealing with directly with Jnana Yoga, Karma Yoga has already been explained in the third chapter. So Bhagwan is dealing only with Jnana Yoga. So if you find this practice difficult, understand mind is not yet fit to practice Jnana Yoga. So then the best thing is, consider God as different from you. The attitude of Dasoham is better. Don't take up Soham attitude. This is Soham. That God is me. I am that God. Fine. Intellectually you understand. Nothing wrong. But for practice, what is the best thing? O God, you are everything. I am nothing. O God, I am your servant. You are the master. You are my father and mother. I am your child. All these things This attitude is better for a devotee whose mind is not yet pure to understand the ultimate Advaitic philosophy. Right. So what does Bhagavan say here? The one who sees actionless consciousness amidst acting body-mind complex, such a person is the wisest among men. Such a person has understood me truly. Right. So now, the description is about how this Mahatma lives his life. Next verse.
Yasya sarve samarambhaha kama sankalpa varjitaha jnanagnidagdha karmanam tamahuf panditam budhaha.
From verse number 19 to 24, we have the description of a Mahatma's life. With this knowledge, how does he live? This is the topic. So what is being said?
Yasya sarve samarambhaha kama sankalpa varjitaha.
In whose actions there is no trace of kama and sankalpa. So this is the one thing.
Yasya sarve samarambhaha. In all his undertakings, in all his actions, what is missing?
Kama and sankalpa is missing. As far as an ordinary person is concerned, an ignorant person is concerned, what is his inspiration to perform action? Inspiration to perform action is the desires. I have so many desires, I have to fulfill these desires, therefore let me work hard in order to get what I desire. So what is the motivating force? It is the desire, isn't it? I want money, so let me work hard for money. I want name, fame, so let me work hard for name and fame. So his motive, his inspiration comes from kama and sankalpa, the object. Now Bhagavan is contrasting ajnani with a jnani. For an ajnani, kama is the driving force. What about a jnani? There is no kama at all. There is no desire. He functions not for happiness, but he functions out of happiness. But then what is the motive force? There has to be some inspiration. If at all there is an inspiration, it is only compassion for the suffering mankind. There is nothing which he desires for himself. Why is it that he doesn't desire anything for himself? All the desire is nothing but desire for happiness. Whatever things, beings, situations you desire in life, what is the ultimate purpose of that desire? It is only to gain happiness. What about this jnani? He is already in happiness. Where is he getting this happiness from? From the very own self, the consciousness, which is Ananda Sarupa. Now when I myself am of the nature of happiness, why should I seek happiness from the outer world? It is not necessary. So therefore, if at all he functions in the world, he functions out of happiness, not for happiness. This is the difference.
Yasya sarve samarambaha kama sankalpa varjitaha.
There is no kama, there is no desire, there is no sankalpa. Sankalpa means imagination. How will I get this object? Where will I get this object? What are the things which I should do to get this object? These are all called sankalpa. Planning. All this planning is driven by the force of desire. So there is no desire and therefore there is no imagination of how I will get happiness from the outer world.
In such a person, jnanagdi dagdha karmanam, all his actions have been burnt in the fire of knowledge.
Now what does it mean? All actions have been burnt in the fire of knowledge. So here, the Mahatmas give the example of this seed. So if you sow a seed, what happens? The seed sprouts. But suppose you roast the seed lightly, what happens? The ability to sprout is destroyed. The seed appears just like any other ordinary seed externally, but because it is roasted slightly, so even if you sow the seed, it doesn't sprout. In the same way, this action which this Mahatma is performing, this action is not capable of producing karma phalas. Just like one seed will create many more seeds after sprouting, in the same way, one action can create many more actions in the form of karma phala. But now that his action is not really action, it has been roasted in the fire of knowledge. Meaning, there is no doership. And since there is no doership, there is no kartrutva bhava, that karma cannot be called as karma. Karma can be called as karma only when there is a sense of doership. Otherwise, there is no karma. For example, suppose you are sleeping and your brother is sleeping next. You kick your brother in sleep. Now, will that be called a karma? Are you fit for punishment because you have kicked your brother during sleep? Are you fit for punishment? No. Because unknowingly I have done. So therefore, there is no punishment. There is no papa involved there. Why? There is no doership. I am deliberately doing it. There is no such thing. It is done unintentionally, unknowingly, without any sense of doership. Therefore, that karma cannot be called as karma. Another example. A child sitting, many times it happens. Pooja Gurudev used to take small children on his lap. And this child started pulling his beard. Now, this child pulling the beard of Swamiji, is it a papa karma? The child doesn't know anything. There is no doership there. In children, there is no ego. So therefore, that action is not an action. So wherever there is no backing of doership for an action, that action cannot be called action. Now what happens to this Mahatma? His identification is not with the acting body. His identification is with the actionless self, actionless consciousness. Therefore, there is no action. Such a person who functions in the world, Bhagwan says, Tamahu Panditam Buddhaha. Buddhaha, wise people call him Pandita. His name is Pandita. What is Pandita? Normally people call these pujaris in the temple as Pandit. Panda means self-knowledge. Itaha means the one who is endowed with. The one endowed with self-knowledge is called Pandita. Right. Moving on for the next verse. Tyaktva karma phala sangam nitya tripto nirashrayah karmanyabhi pravrittopi naiva kinchit karoti sah. Yes. So even when he is performing action, tyaktva karma phala asangam. So even when he is performing action, there is no asangam, there is no attachment for the karma phala. As far as an ordinary person is concerned, all his action is for the results, karma phala. What about this person? There is absolutely no attachment towards karma phala. And since he is not attached to karma phala, there is no worry, there is no anxiety, there is no stress, there is no strain. Mind is totally relaxed. And since mind is relaxed, his action is the most efficient. Because whenever the mind is at peace, you are at your best. And then, what is his condition? Nitya triptaha, eternally contented. Triptaha, totally contented. Why is he totally contented? Because the nature of the self is contentment. The nature of the self is peace. The nature of the self is happiness. The nature of the self is fulfillment. Now, since he is identified to this self, the properties of the self, properties of the consciousness, he experiences nitya truptaha, eternally contented. And nirashrayaha, totally independent, he doesn't hang on to something, without any ashraya. Ashraya from the world, you have to understand this. Why he doesn't take refuge in the world? Because he has taken refuge in the ultimate consciousness, which is the very refuge to the world. We take refuge in the world because the world is the source of happiness for us. He takes refuge in consciousness. Therefore, he need not take refuge in the world. In fact, the whole world exists in consciousness. The whole world takes refuge in consciousness. And where does the consciousness take refuge? It need not take refuge anywhere. Why? Because it is Sat Vastu. It is the ultimate truth. The ultimate truth need not take refuge anywhere else. A false thing have to take refuge somewhere else. False things will have to take refuge in the truth. The truth need not take refuge anywhere. For example, the snake in the rope. Where does the snake take refuge in? The rope. Snake has no existence other than rope. The illusory snake has to take refuge in the real rope. All illusions take refuge in the real. Consciousness is the ultimate reality. It is Sat Vastu. It is existence. Existence means what? That alone exists. If at all you think that something other than consciousness exists, understand it is an illusory existence. It is a borrowed existence. According to our experience, what do we say? The whole world is existing. Isn't it? Now we ask the question, where is the world existing? So we say, in our mind it is existing. Fine. Where is the mind existing? Mind is nothing but thoughts. It exists in consciousness. So world is existing in the mind. Mind is existing in consciousness. So therefore, where does the world exist? In consciousness. So that is the ultimate refuge for everything. Now this Mahatma has taken refuge in consciousness, therefore, nirashraya. Right. Mayeva sakalam jatam, mai sarvam pratishthitam. Mai sarvam layam yati, tad brahmadvayam asmiham, Upanishad says. From me everything has come. In me everything exists. And into me everything dissolves. That ultimate non-dual Brahman I am. This is the experience of a Mahatma. So he is absolutely independent. Nirashraya. Now these are all the glories of this knowledge. As far as an ignorant person is concerned, he says, I am in the world. What does a jnani say? The world is in me. Without me, there is no existence for the world. The world depends on me for its existence. This is the statement. The infinite cosmos doesn't have an existence of its own. It exists because I exist. I give existence to this cosmos. This is the way in which jnani thinks. Just imagine. Nirashraya. And then karmanyabhipravirtopi. You will find this Mahatma. Now there are varieties of Mahatmas. The varieties of Mahatmas are going to be described. Now here is a Mahatma who is fully involved. Very, very active Mahatma. Karmani abhipravirta. Fully busy. 18 hours, 19 hours working. Maybe he is a family person also. Maybe he is taking care of his business also. He may be taking care of his children, his grandchildren. He may appear to be like any other worldly person. Karmani abhipravirtopi, but naiva kinchit karoti saha. He actually speaking, he doesn't do anything. He is doing so many things, but actually he is not doing anything. Now what does it mean? From the standpoint of the worldly people, he appears to do so many things. Very, very busy person. But from his own standpoint, what is his experience? I don't do anything. Take the example of fire. Fire is cooking this food, that food, doing so many things. You ask fire, what are you doing anything? What will fire say? I don't do anything. I am just there. Isn't it? Or another wonderful example is the sun example. Everything on this planet happens because of the rising and setting of sun. Isn't it? When the sun rises, we also rise. All activities start on this world when the sun rises. And when the sun sets, all activities subside. So many things happen in this world with the rising and setting of sun. Now you ask sun, oh my dear sun, you do so many activity. What will the sun say? What rising, what setting? I don't do anything. From the standpoint of the sun, there is no action at all. Isn't it? Karmanyabhipravirtopi naiva kinchit karoti saha. From his own standpoint, he doesn't do anything because he is identified with actionless consciousness. Next one.
Nirashiryata chittatma tyakta sarva parigraha shariram kevalam karma kurvannapnoti kilbisham.
Now here is a description of another Mahatma. So earlier, a Mahatma who is fully active in this world, karmanyabhipravirtaha, fully active, such a Mahatma was described. Now there is another Mahatma. What is he doing? He is not doing anything. Nirashi, free from asha, free from hope, free from expectation, free from desires. And then, yata chitta atma, with his mind fully tamed, disciplined, controlled, is a master of his mind. Yata chitta atma. How has he gained the mastery over the mind? Mind always seeks happiness. What does mind want? Happiness. So why does the mind wander in the world? Mind wanders in order to get some happiness. Why does the mind seeks indulgence in pleasures? Because it wants happiness. Since the mind is starved, as far as an ignorant person, that mind is starved of happiness. Because this ignorant person is not giving the highest happiness, so where will the mind go in order to get happiness? It will have to beg from the outer world. This begging of the mind for happiness is called wandering mind. So mind thinks, maybe this will give me happiness, maybe this person will give me happiness, maybe this situation will give me happiness. So how to get this situation, how to get this object, how to get this person? Mind is wandering. But now what is the condition of the mind of a Mahatma? That mind has got the highest joy from one's own self. So that mind is a highly educated mind. That mind knows where to seek happiness. So that mind always abides in the self. So therefore that mind is fully tamed and disciplined. Right? It need not wander outside. It ever remains rooted within. Gurudev used to give the example of our dog. If you are not feeding your dog properly, where will the dog go? Your own dog, where will it go? You keep forgetting to feed and all that. You are not taking the dog properly. So naturally the dog will go outside, isn't it? It will wander into the streets. It will eat all filth and come back. But suppose you are giving the best imported dog food. Full. So such a dog will be santushtaha, truptaha. So that dog will not go anywhere, isn't it? It will always remain at your feet. Our mind is also like this dog. Give the mind the best happiness. That happiness which has no side effects. Worldly happiness is full of side effects. Little happiness and lot of pain. That is worldly happiness. What about the bliss of the self? Yasya brahmani ramate chittam nandati nandati nandatyeva. There is no end. It is infinite happiness for infinite period of time without any kind of side effects. That is a kind of joy you experience in the self. So once the mind tastes that higher joy, the mind naturally becomes dispassionate towards the lower pleasures of the world. Such a mind is called a sublimated mind. The mind which drops the lower pleasures because it has tasted the higher joys of life. Such a mind will ever remain tamed, will ever be disciplined, will ever remain obedient. It's a wonderful slave. Yata chittatma. So once the mind is tamed, all the sense organs also remains tamed. Because sense organs are guided by the mind. Mind is tamed, so his entire personality is disciplined. Yata chittatma. Now what kind of mahatma is this? Tyakta sarva parigraha. He has given up all kinds of parigraha. Parigraha means hoarding. Hoarding tendency is called parigraha. I want this also, I want that also. Everything you keep on hoarding. Why do you hoard? Maybe tomorrow it may be useful. Today it may not be useful, but tomorrow. The hoarding tendency is called parigraha. We hoard so much that even the fused bulbs we keep. Maybe for something we can use. Isn't it? Torn clothes also we keep. If you just open the almar in any house, things will just pop out. It is stuffed with things. This is called parigraha buddhi. You don't want to throw away anything. You want to keep everything. This parigraha buddhi comes from a sense of insecurity. I am not secure, so I need so many things to keep myself secure. The sense of insecurity expresses itself as tendency to hoard, tendency to accumulate. But this Mahatma is absolutely secure in his own self. Because this consciousness can never, the existence of this consciousness is never threatened by even the greatest calamity of the world. Nainam chindanti shastrani, nainam dahati pavakaha. The weapons cannot cut it. The fire cannot burn it. Water cannot wet it. And air cannot dry it. Second chapter. That is the glory of this Atma. Even when the world goes into dissolution, pralaya, consciousness remains. That is the glory of consciousness. So this Mahatma is holding on to such a secure truth, which is the self, and therefore there is no tendency to hoard, accumulate. So here the description is about a what you call parivrajaka sannyasi. No wife, no children, no home, nothing. A total beggar. But the mind fully tamed. No desires, no hopes, no expectation. And what is he doing? How does he spend his time? Shariram kevalam karma kuruvan. The only thing he does from morning till evening is take care of the body. Shariram karma. Body needs food, he feeds the body. Body needs rest, he gives rest to the body. Shariram karma it is called. Whole day he takes care of the body. Of course, he takes care of the body as an instrument of the Lord. Does he do any service activity? Nothing. Eat, drink, sleep, be merry, happy. Shariram kevalam karma kurvan. Even then, na apnoti kilbisham. He doesn't incur sin. He is not doing any kind of service. What is he doing? Shariram karma. Whatever the body needs, he does. That's all. But Bhagavan says, even his non-performance of action doesn't incur him any sin. Whether he does or he doesn't do anything, it doesn't matter. Now here, the description is about a perfect sannyasi. Right? Many times people have this idea about jnanis. A jnani should be like this. A jnani should be like that. What Bhagavan is trying to say is, by the external behavior of a person, you will never know who is a jnani and who is an ajnani. You can never even guess. A jnani can be highly active in the society. A jnani can appear to be highly worldly. And a jnani can appear to be highly introverted. All varieties of jnanis are there. The problem with us is, when we see a very active jnani, we say, oh, this person is a very rajasic person. I don't think he has gained knowledge. If he has gained knowledge, why is it that he is not keeping quiet? His mind is restless, therefore he is running around. Right? When we see an active jnani, this is what we say. When we see an inactive jnani, what do we say? Useless fellow, good for nothing, doing no service. I don't think he is a jnani. Right? So Bhagavan is saying, don't, with your limited knowledge, don't try to rate who is a jnani and who is a ajnani. By external behavior, you can never know. In Mahabharata, a butcher is described as a jnani. A yogi goes to a butcher to learn self-knowledge. And again, he is taught self-knowledge by another woman who is a householder lady who was taking care of her husband, and then this yogi goes. All the stories are there in Mahabharata. So you can never know who is a jnani and who is an ajnani. But yes, when you become a jnani, you know who is a jnani. An ajnani can never know a jnani. A jnani will know another jnani. That's all. Right. So this is a description of another jnani who is not doing anything. Shariram kevalam karma kurvan na apnoti kilbisham. He is free from the taints of action. Next one.
Yadrachalabha santoshtah dvandvatito vimatsarah samasiddhava siddhaucha kritvapina nibadhyate.
Yes. Another characteristics. What is it? Yadrachha labha santushtaha. Whatever comes by chance. Yadrachha labha. What is his attitude? Santushta. He is happy. Contented. Whatever comes by chance, without any effort. Whatever comes out of prarabdha, without any serious seeking, whatever comes automatically to him, with that he is contented. Meaning, no complaining at all, no grumbling at all. Yadrachha labha santushta. Then, dvandva atita, the one who is beyond dvandva. Dvandva means pairs of opposite. Now, the world is full of pairs of opposites. What are the pairs of opposites? Shita Ushna, heat and cold, Sukha Dukkha, joys and sorrows, pleasures and pains, victory defeat, success failure, profit loss, honor dishonor, praise criticism, isn't it? Sukha Dukkha, Mana Apamana, all these are pairs of opposites. Birth, death, health, sickness. Then Sanyoga Vyoga, coming together and separation. Jnana Hatjnana, yes. Right? So the whole world is full of pairs of opposites. Now, what is his attitude? द्वंद्वातीत. He is absolutely undisturbed by these pairs of opposites. The external ups and downs in the situations doesn't create any kind of fluctuation in his mind, disturbance in his mind. He has a very good shock absorber, in short. The road is full of potholes, full of bumps, but suppose you have a very good shock absorber, then what happens? If the car is having a very good shock absorber, you don't feel the shock, isn't it? You can't change the road, but you can change the vehicle. Now here, in this Mahatma, he has a very good shock absorber, because of which all these pairs of opposite coming from the world, where we have no control at all, it just comes. As far as the external situations are concerned, we have absolutely no control over them. Maybe a little control is there, that's all. But as far as the condition of the mind is concerned, as far as the environment of the mind is concerned, we have total freedom. Situations we don't have control, but the state of mind, it is totally under our control. Now what is his condition? His mind is absolutely at peace. External situations cannot dictate terms to him. He is a master of all situations. The situations cannot dictate terms to him. He is a master of all situations. Dvandvatitah. Why is he dvandvatitah? Everything has to be related. Because he has this knowledge. Huh? That is how it is. All these are called, what you call, siddhasya lakshanani. These are natural for a siddha. What should a sadhaka do? Sadhakasya sadhanani. These are all sadhanas for a sadhaka. We should try to develop these virtues, which is natural in a jnani. These things are natural in a jnani because he is holding on to the ultimate. Therefore, all these things are natural. Dunduatita. So when you cut a jackfruit, what do? Those who have cut jackfruit. If you directly get that fruit from the market, then you don't know. What happens if you cut a jackfruit? There is that white liquid, isn't it? You can mess up your life if you get into that liquid directly. So what is the first thing to be done? Apply oil and then cut. This jnani also has applied oil. What is this oil? The oil of knowledge. So he has applied the oil of knowledge, so therefore the messy worldly life cannot mess up his mind. His mind is at peace. He is also handling all the problems in life, ups and downs, etc. Everything comes to him. Now, so there are some people who say, suppose you are a jnani, then problems will not come to him. Now, please keep all these foolish notions away. There are people, I have studied so much of Bhagavad Gita, I pray so much, even then Bhagwan did this to me. Right. Remember, what is the purpose of spiritual knowledge? Don't say that I have spiritual knowledge, therefore problems will not come to me. No, problems will come. Dvandva will happen. But what is the difference between a jnani and a jnani? A jnani is fully disturbed, jnani remains undisturbed. This is the difference. Problems will come according to Prarabdha. Ramakrishna Paramsa suffered from cancer. Ramana Maharshi suffered from cancer. Now there are some people who say, such a great devotee, even then cancer. It will come. It all depends on the past karma phala, isn't it? Prarabdha karma. What is there in Prarabdha, nobody knows. Anything can come. Right? So therefore, see the next term. Samasiddhavasiddhaucha. There can be siddhi, there can be asiddhi. There can be success, there can be failure. Bhagwan Sri Krishna is not teaching us how to ever succeed in life. That is not the teaching. There are situations when you will have to fail. There are situations. Even a jnani also fails. A mahatma also fails. Why to talk? Even Bhagwan has failed many, many times. He went as a messenger, isn't it? Duta. In order to avoid the war. Did he succeed? He was a failure. So Bhagavad Gita doesn't teach us how to succeed all the time. Bhagavad Gita teaches us how to remain undisturbed even among failures. That is what Bhagavad Gita teaches us. So we have to be very clear. And then vimatsaraha. Vimatsaraha means what? Free from jealousy, free from competition. Matsara comes from a very interesting word. Matta sarati iti matsara. He is moving ahead of me. Mattaha. Compared to me, matta sarati. Somebody is moving ahead of me. So from matta sarati comes the term matsara. Matsara means competition. Matsara means jealousy. So what is this jnani's state of mind? Free from all kinds of jealousies. What is the root cause of jealousy? Root cause of jealousy is desire, attachment, kama, raga. So you badly love something, you are badly attached to something, and somebody has more than what you have. Then what comes is called jealousy. You like something, and somebody is having more than what you have. Then what happens? Jealousy comes. But suppose there is nothing which you love badly. Then where is the question of jealousy? Also, in this world, desired objects are few, desirers are many. So everyone will not get desired object. Desired objects are few, desirers are many, isn't it? Vacancy for a job, maybe 10, but how many apply? Hundreds apply. Will everyone get a job? No. So there is a competition. Who gets first? Isn't it? In this world, always it is like that. Desired objects are few, desirers are many. So naturally, competition is unavoidable. But what about the self? This self is equally available in all in full measure. So if there are 10 people who are striving for enlightenment or striving for God, so how much God will they get? If there are 10 people, can you say God by 10? Suppose there is a cake and 10 people want to have that cake. So how much will each person get? 1 by 10. So now there are 10 people who are striving for God. So can you say 1/10 of God only they will get? No. The beauty of spirituality is everyone can strive and everyone will get full. Happiness is infinite. Contentment is infinite. Absolute in full measure. So this Mahatma is the one who is experiencing infinity. Then where is the question of this petty jealousies, petty competition and all? If you find that somebody wants, he says, take, go. He will not compete and all that. Cheap, narrow-minded people, selfish people only compete. What do wise people do? They cooperate. Right? What do Mahatmas do? If they find that somebody is interested in something, they just give, take. Somebody gave Mahatma Gandhi a very, very, what you call, high-grade, costly slippers from London. So Mahatma Gandhi was wearing it. So one day, what happened was his train was little. So he came little late and train was just leaving. So in that hurry-burry, he just got into the train and in the process, one slipper fell down. You know what Mahatma Gandhi did? He dropped the other slipper also. His idea was, what is the use of one slipper? Whoever gets it, let him get both so that he can make use of it. This is the attitude of Mahatmas. They don't compete for things.
Vimatsaraha samaha siddhava siddhaucha krittvapi nadibadhyate.
Such a person, even when he performs action, he doesn't perform action. Actions are like sprouted seeds, as I told. Or it is something like a tree without root. Sometimes in functions, etc., we have this plantain tree, isn't it? You cut it and then you tie it. Now, will it grow? Externally, it appears as though there is a tree. But will it grow? Roots are not there. So, in the same way, Mahatma's actions also. Those actions cannot produce any evil consequences. Next one, verse number 23.
Gata sangasya muktasya jnanavasthita chetasah yajnayacharatah karma samagram praviliyate.
Gata sangasya. The one in whom sangha is gata, gone, devoid of sangha, devoid of attachment. He is neither attached to the action nor is he attached to the results of the action. Such a person, muktasya, who is free, liberated. When? Not after death, liberated while living. Many people think moksha is after death. As far as Vedanta is concerned, moksha is while living. Nobody becomes liberated after death. If you are liberated while living, then only you are liberated after death. If you are bound while living, you will remain bound after death also. So such a person, he is a Jeevan Mukta. Jeevan Mukta means even while living, he is liberated. Muktasya. So what is the root cause of liberation? When I, the pure consciousness, identify with the body, that is bondage. Identification with the body is bondage. Disidentification with the body is liberation. Identification with consciousness is liberation. I come to know that I am not this body at all. I come to know that I am the observer of this body, mind, intellect. I am the ultimate Sakshi. So this Sakshi has nothing to do with the body. Just as I observe something, so naturally that thing has nothing to do with me. Observer is always different from the observed. So this knowledge, one who is rooted in this knowledge, such a person is Mukta Purusha. The ego is totally burned. The ego is totally, what you call, vanquished, destroyed. There is no ego. What remains there is only a state of being. I am. Only that is there. There is no state of becoming. There is only state of being. So such a person is liberated while living. Muktasya. And this mukti, how did he get? Jnanavasthita chetasaha. Because his mind is firmly rooted in this knowledge. Knowledge has given him this liberation. And now what is this? Now here is a third type of person. What does he do? Yajnaya acharata karma. What kind of action does he do? He does yajna karma. Yajna karma means selfless service. Yajna means sacrifice. So what kind of actions does he perform? Actions of sacrifice. Now that he has nothing to gain, he has gained everything. So then how does he live his life? Maybe he is expressing his gratitude towards his teacher. Oh Guru, you have given me this knowledge. Now let me give this knowledge to others also. I have nothing to gain, but I am grateful to you. Let me express my gratitude by offering my service unto the mankind. So that's this person does. How does he live? A life of yajna, a life of service, selfless service. In such a person, Bhagavan says, samagram karma praviliyate. All his actions are dissolved. Samagram. Here Bhagavan Shankaracharya gives a different meaning. Samagram means agra, means that which is in front. Sam plus agra. Sam means saha, along with. Along with that which is in front. So what comes in front of karma? Karma phala, isn't it? After karma comes karma phala. So agra means karma phala. Sam means saha, along with. Along with what? Along with karma. So karma and karma phala, samagra means. Samagram karma praviliyate. It gets dissolved. So you will find varieties of people. Some are very much active in the worldly plane. A grihasthashrami, fulfilling his worldly responsibilities, he can be a jnani. And another person, totally a recluse, given up everything, remains like a parivrajaka sannyasi. That is also possible. Or there can be a possible where there is a swami or a sannyasi who is functioning for the welfare of the world, loka sangraha. That is also possible. Meaning, all varieties are possible. You can't just say, jnani must be like this only or like that only. You can't say that. According to their prarabdhas, according to their previous vasanas, whichever they have cultivated earlier before knowledge, that will express. That is a point. So in the society itself, you will find Ramakrishna's behavior was very much different from Vivekananda's behavior. Taponji Maharaj's behavior, he was exactly like that Parivrajaka Sannyasi, Taponji Maharaj. Nothing. Tyatta Sarva Parigraha. Even he did not used to take medicine also, even when some sickness used to come. He used to just watch the body. That was the kind of person. Tyatta Sarva Parigraha. Taponji Maharaj was one type. Gurudev was totally different. Isn't it? So in society you will find all these kinds of people. Varieties are there. But what is common in them? So all these discussions, what are the things which we find in common? Number one, total freedom from the results of the action. Total freedom means totally detached from the results of the action. This is what we find. Number two, firm abidance in the truth. This is common in all. Whether you are working or not working, these are all the common things. Firm abidance in the truth. Then, remaining untainted by action. Then, totally contented. No complaining, no grumbling. Then, nitya truptaha. Then, yatachittatma. Absolute mastery over one's own mind and the senses. Yatachittatma. Then, dundvatitaha. Unaffected by the pairs of opposites. Then, free from all negativities of the mind, like kama, krodha, lobha, moha, etc. Vimatsara. Free from all kinds of negative emotions. This is common in all. Then, muktaha, liberated while living. Then, nirashraya, psychologically independent. No dependence on anything or anyone. So these are all the common characteristics in a jnani. Now these are all internal characteristics. You cannot see it outside. Right. Now comes a very famous verse which describes a jnani. What kind of life he leads. Very famous verse.
ब्रह्मार्पणं ब्रह्महविः ब्रह्माग्नौ ब्रह्मणाहुतं ब्रह्मैव तेन गन्तव्यं ब्रह्मकर्म समाधिना.
This is the verse which we chant before taking food. So many times when we chant this, we remember food only. Right. So what is being said? So here is a vision of a jnani. What does he see? Brahmarpanam. For him, arpanam is Brahma. What is arpanam? So now, here is a description of a very sacred act called performing a yaga or havana or homa. It's a very sacred act. So in yaga, what all things are there? There is a fire in that homa kunda. And then you keep on offering things. And there is a person who is offering. Right? And he is offering for a particular result. And he is offering with a particular thing. All those things are there. So now, what is the vision of a jnani? Brahma arpanam. Arpana means that with which you offer. So the ladle is called arpanam. That stick. Not stick actually. Into which? Sruva, correct. You pour oil and that, what you call ghee. Yes, you pour ghee, and to pour ghee you use a long stick, sruva. It is called sruva. That ladle is called arpanam. Or it can also mean the result for which this offering is done. The person who is performing the yaga, he has some result. So that result also can be arpanam. Or that devata unto whom he is worshipping, that also can be arpanam. Or the deshakala, the time and the place where the offering is done, that also can be arpanam. So all these meanings can be there for that arpanam. So what is a jnani's vision? That arpanam is Brahman. And then Brahma Havihi. Havis means the thing which you are offering. Whatever you offer, ghee or the rice ball or whatever, that Havis is also Brahman. And what is that fire? Brahmagnau. That fire is also Brahman. And who is offering? Brahmanahutam. The one who is offering, he is also Brahman. And what is the name of the jnani? Here Bhagavan says, the name of the jnani is Brahma Karma Samadhi. What is the name of the jnani? Brahma Karma Samadhi. What is this Brahma Karma Samadhi? Brahma Eva Karma Brahma Karma. Tasmin Brahmani Samadhi Brahma Karma Samadhi. Means what? All actions for a jnani is nothing but Brahman, Bhagavan alone. His mind is fully absorbed in Brahman. Samadhi means absorption. Where is his mind absorbed? His mind is absorbed in consciousness or Brahman or God. So the one who sees Brahman alone in all actions, and the one whose mind is fully absorbed in Brahman, such a person's name is called Brahma Karma Samadhi. Where will he go? Such a person who is a Brahma Karma Samadhi, where will he go? Brahmaiva tena gantavya. Since his mind is absorbed in Brahman, so after death, where will he go? He will go to Brahman only. Rather, there is no going to Brahman, he has become Brahman. So what is pointed out is, when he is living in this world, what does he see? He sees only God and God alone. Sarvam Brahmamayam Rere Sarvam Brahmamayam. The world he sees as God. Body he sees as God. Instruments, resources he sees as God. Talents, abilities, God. Time, place, God. His mind is fully absorbed in that God. What does he see? He doesn't see anything other than God. Just like a gold merchant, if he is handling bangles, necklace, ring, what else? Bracelets, earring, nose ring. So he is handling gold. So what can we call him? Gold Samadhi. Though he is handling so many different things, where is his mind? He is seeing only gold and gold alone, isn't it? His attention is only in gold. So he can be called Gold Samadhi. In the same way, this Mahatma is Brahma Karma Samadhi. So while eating food, we chant this mantra, because while eating food also, we are doing a kind of yaga only. A yajna is done. So what is the fire into which you offer? The fire is the jataragni. The fire of hunger. Digestive fire is the fire. So what is the havis you offer? The food is the havis. And what is the ladle? Sruva. The hand is the sruva. And who is offering? I am offering. To which devata are you offering? You are offering to the devata called Jivatma, the individual. Correct. So there is a yajna going on. Right. So before eating we chant this to remind ourselves that everything is God alone. This digestive fire is Bhagwan. The food is given by Bhagwan. The ability to digest is given by Bhagwan. The ability to take food and put it into the mouth, that is also given by Bhagwan. Everything is Bhagwan alone. So that at least while eating, you will remember Bhagwan. And eating is one thing which you can't avoid. Puja, japa, meditation, etc. we may avoid. Eating, can we avoid? So, our Rishi Munis, compassionate ones, they said, at least while eating, before eating, you remember Bhagwan. So, at least three times you will remember. Brahma Karma Samadhi. More of it, we will see tomorrow.
Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah, Sarve Santu Niramayah, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kaschid Dukha Bhag Bhavet, Asatoma Sadgamaya, Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya, Mrityorma Amritam Gamaya. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.